It looks like this inflation might be getting a little bit worse because a lot of government officials thought that this inflation that we were seeing was just temporary, but now economists are coming out and they're saying that this inflation that we're seeing is going to be around for a long time. What's up, everybody? I'm Jaspreet Singh from TheMinorityMindset.com, where money minds rethink rich. Everybody has been feeling the effects of this inflation. Home prices have skyrocketed to new record highs, car prices keep going up, grocery prices keep going up, and now they're saying that we are seeing the highest levels of inflation in more than 13 years. That's when a lot of people started to get upset, saying, why are we seeing all this inflation? And then to calm everybody down, the Federal Reserve Bank, who is in charge of our monetary system, kept coming out and saying that this inflation that we're seeing is just temporary, it's transitory, and right now the thing that's causing the prices of everything to go up isn't inflation, it's the supply chain issues, is these bottlenecks that we've seen in the economy, and it's a labor shortage. And as soon as those things get fixed, we're gonna see the prices of everything come back down. So it's not really inflation. You have nothing to worry about. But now economists are not so sure. They're starting to doubt the Federal Reserve Bank, and they're saying that we are seeing real inflation, and this extra inflation that we are seeing could be around for a long time. Let me read this first line from a Wall Street Journal article titled, "Higher Inflation is Here to Stay for Years, Economists Forecast." What this article starts with is, Americans should brace themselves for several years of higher inflation than they've seen in decades. So let's talk about what's going on with this higher inflation and what you should be doing with your money. That way you can continue to build your wealth and make smart money moves. But before we get into that, I need you to do me a quick favor and smash the thumbs up button below. And if you haven't already, be sure to check out our new YouTube Shorts channel, where we put out small clips of Minority Mindset videos. So if you're looking for bite-sized pieces, I got the link to how you can check out our Minority Mindset Shorts channel in the description below. So the whole premise behind this Wall Street Journal article is that in July of 2021, the Wall Street Journal interviewed a bunch of different economists, and they wanted to get their opinions in July of 2021 and compare that with their opinions about inflation back from April of 2021, and they want to kind of get a trend of how people's opinions are changing about inflation over time and what they think about what's going to happen in the future. The general consensus is that back in April, many economists listened to what the Fed said, and they thought that all this inflation was just going to be transitory and it would go away. And now it looks like a lot of economists think that this inflation is going to be around for a while. One chief economist said, quote, "We are in a transitional phase right now where we are transitioning to a higher period of inflation and interest rates than we have seen over the last 20 years. Essentially, what he's saying is that over the last couple decades or so, we've seen relatively low inflation. We've seen inflation at right around 2% or under 2% for the last couple years. And so many people have kind of changed their investing strategies and their budgeting strategies around these inflation numbers. And now he's expecting this to change. He's expecting inflation to go up quite a bit over the next couple decades. And now economists and lawmakers might have to change the way they think about money too. What the article says is that this shift to a period of higher inflation could create new challenges for households, policymakers, and investors who have come to expect inflation to be around or below 2% a year. If you live off of a fixed income, or you've been investing your money to get some sort of fixed income, and now you make this much money, but your expenses keep going up, that's not going to be good, because now you're going to have to lower your lifestyle in order to be able to survive, because you're just not going to have enough money to keep being able to afford things, because high inflation means the prices of things are going to keep going up because the value of your dollars are being diluted. The thing that's really interesting here, though, is how more and more economists are starting to doubt the Fed and their policies. Because what the Fed said in a recent report is the Fed came out again and they said that this inflation that we're seeing is just transitory. It's due to hiring difficulties, it's due to the labor shortage, and it's due to other largely transitory factors, meaning the Federal Reserve Bank is still saying publicly that this inflation that we're seeing is going to go away quickly. But if you read just a couple paragraphs later, economists don't agree. Another chief economist here says, quote, "Inflation is expected to surge longer and longer than the Fed previously thought." And because these economists are starting to doubt the Fed, they're concerned that the Fed is going to move too quickly, which is going to hurt our economy even more in the long term. You have another chief economist that said, quote, "The danger is that monetary authorities, aka the Federal Reserve Bank, are behind the curve." Then he goes on to say, "I'm not saying hyperinflation is around the corner. It's just that a lot of things have come together in the last year, and the overall trend of costs across the board is growing faster than in the last 5 or 10 years. Essentially, what he's saying is that the Federal Reserve Bank should look a little bit deeper into the inflation that we're seeing, because if the Federal Reserve Bank doesn't do anything to control our monetary supply, to kind of control our inflation, then we people could end up paying the cost for years into the future, because inflation is just going to keep ramping up if we don't stop it while we can. According to this article, there are three main reasons why businesses have been raising the price of their products. Number one is plentiful federal stimulus funding. Second is an unprecedented stockpile of household savings. And the third is a rollout of vaccines driving up the surge in consumer demand. So why is the price of everything going up according to this article? For one, we had a ton of money printing happen in 2020 and 2021. What that did was it diluted the value of our dollars. And so now you need more dollars in order to buy things. So the raw cost of businesses needing to buy things has gone up. And we also have a labor shortage where you have a lot of people that are still out of a job, either because they're scared of getting sick or because they're getting more money through unemployment, so they don't want to go back to work. Whatever the case is, you have a lot of people that are not working, so there's a higher cost of doing business and the value of our dollars have been diluted. Second, people have cash in the bank. So this is interesting here because what probably happened is businesses are starting to realize, okay, we have higher costs, the value of dollars are being diluted. So then businesses try to just kind of slowly raise the price of things and they see, oh, this is not affecting sales. People are still buying our stuff just as much. And so now businesses have the ability to keep raising prices because people are still willing to buy things. I've talked about this in a previous video where car prices are way more expensive now than before. And the reason why companies can support these higher prices because people keep buying the cars because they feel like they can afford it because they have cash in the bank. Right now, a lot of people have cash in the bank either because they got free money from the government or because they didn't have a lot of expenses in 2020 and 2021 because they were quarantining or they were at home or whatever the case might be. And so you have a lot of people with cash in the bank who are willing to go out and spend money because everybody feels that this pandemic is finally over. And so now all of a sudden you have this massive demand for people wanting to go out, travel, enjoy life, buy things because they have cash in the bank. And these three things together have pushed businesses to raise prices, which is why the price of everything keeps going up. So what does this higher inflation mean? Well, according to this article, high inflation for several years would ripple through the economy in various ways. What it says is that consumers could find their household budget squeezed because now you got to pay more money to buy things. Second, higher borrowing costs could weigh on stock values because you have a lot of people trading on margin. And it's not just people, it's institutions too, because right now you have institutions borrowing hundreds of millions of dollars and investing this money into the stock market because they can borrow money so cheap. But if borrowing money becomes more expensive, they're not going to be able to borrow as much money because it's going to cost more money. It could also crimp growth in interest rate sensitive industries like housing because most people go out to buy a home with a mortgage. And if it's more expensive for you to get a mortgage because interest rates go up, you're going to see less people going out to buy a home, which could hurt the demand to buy a home, which could slow down housing growth. And finally, higher inflation could also make it harder for businesses to plan long-term investments because if you can't be sure what your costs are, it's going to be very hard for you to get supplies now or 6 months from now. So now the question is, what do you do? Where do you put your money? That way you can get the best return on your money. And this is where a lot of people try to guess, oh, this is exactly where I need to put my money. I need to put my money in this stock or in this asset class because this is the asset class that will win. But it's impossible for somebody to predict the future. Nobody knows what's going to happen. Yeah, you can guess. Maybe you'll be right. If you're right, you can win big. But if you're wrong, you can also lose big. This is where you got to understand, okay, how do I diversify smartly? Because there's a way to diversify your money smartly. And then there's a dumb way to diversify your money. But if you're diversifying your money, you want to make sure you're putting your money in the right places in different asset classes. That way you can get the best return on your money. That way if one asset class goes down, you're not completely hurt because you'll have your money in different asset classes. One way to really diversify some of your assets is by investing some of your money in art. And one of the easiest ways to do that is to use someone like our sponsor Masterworks.io, who is the premier membership for investing into contemporary art. The thing that makes art interesting as an investment is that when people have extra money, they buy more art. I mean, Deloitte even said that they expect the art market to grow to $900 billion by 2026. Look, art is not a traditional investment, but it is a way for you to diversify your money from stocks and real estate. And contemporary art prices have outperformed the S&P 500 over the last 25 years by more than 150%. That's one of the reasons why you see the super wealthy put a chunk of their portfolio into art because they want that diversification. No one knows what's gonna win. The problem with investing in art is it's expensive. If you don't have an extra $10 million laying around, it's not very easy or accessible for regular people to just go out and start investing in fine art. But that's what Masterworks.io is changing because they make investing in art more accessible because now you can go out and you can invest in art pieces by people like Picasso at a fraction of the entry cost. And the best part of all is that Masterworks.io is letting you, Minority Mindset fans, skip their entire 17,000 person waitlist. So if you want to learn more and see how you can potentially start investing in art at a fraction of the cost, I got the link to how you can learn more in the description below. By the way, if you want to see more of the important information and the legal information, you can learn more about that at masterworks.io/disclaimer. So if you want to learn more and see how you can potentially start investing in art, I got the link to how you can do that with their sponsor in the description below. For those of you investing in stocks and real estate, you have a couple different options. Option one is you can say, you know, I think we're going to see higher inflation, and I think this is going to push interest rates up. And when interest rates go up, I think the stock market and real estate prices are going to come down, or at least start to stabilize, and then I'll start to invest my money. Option two is you can say, well, I don't know what's gonna happen in the future and I don't wanna try to predict the future. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna keep investing my money like normal every month or every 2 months, or I'm gonna be looking for deals and then I'll just continue investing my money. And if prices come down, I'm gonna come and invest even more. Personally, I stick with option two. It is impossible to predict what's gonna happen in the future, how big something's gonna be in the future, or when something is gonna happen in the future, especially when the Federal Reserve Bank keeps kind of changing things, the government keeps changing the programs, so it's impossible to predict what's going to happen in the future. And instead, I want you to just be a smart investor and understand the risks. And if things do go bad, that's when you want to come in and invest even more. So you got to kind of understand the different scenarios and know how to invest your money based off of all the possibilities that could happen in the future. So, like, when it comes to me investing my money in the stock market, I do a couple different things. One, I have this automatic withdrawal that happens every single week. So money gets automatically withdrawn from my personal bank account, and this money automatically gets invested into a few ETFs. This happens every single week. And then I have money that I use to invest in individual stocks. So when I find a deal, or if I'm investing in certain companies and I see the price of this company go down and I still believe in the value of this company. So these are companies that I'm spending time researching and keeping up on. If I believe in the value of these companies, which I do if I'm spending all this time researching it, and the price hits a certain point where I think it's a good price, then I will come in to buy. But I'm not just gonna be chasing stocks. I'm looking for deals. So when it comes to the stock market, I'm looking for deals. I'm not gonna go in and try to run up prices or try to chase prices. I'm looking for deals. If I see a deal, I will buy. If I don't see a deal, it's okay. I'll wait on the sidelines until I see a deal. But even if I don't do that, I have money being invested every single week into certain ETFs that I believe in for the long term. When it comes to my real estate investments, I took a break from real estate after the 2020 pandemic first hit because I had no idea what was going on. I didn't know what was going to happen to the economy. I had no idea what was going on with our health crisis. And now I've started to come back into real estate. I am still being extremely picky, and that's a little bit tough right now because we are in this crazy seller's market where it is very hard to find a deal. And so I am getting outbid on a lot of different deals. But again, I don't want to chase properties. I don't want to overpay for anything. If we see real estate prices come down, I will come in and I will buy much more aggressively. But I also don't want to wait until who knows how long before I start buying. And so it's a little bit more work for me right now because I got to look at a lot of properties. I'm making a lot of offers and I get rejected on a lot of offers, but the deals that I do get are great deals. And so that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the undervalued deals where I can come in and I can add value and that I can buy properties at a price that makes sense for me. I'm not trying to overpay for anything. I know that inflation is probably going to be around for a while, but I also don't want to chase my investments and I also don't want to overpay for my investments. So this is where I'm trying to just be cautious. If I'm going to make an individual investment decision, I have to make sure it makes sense. So I'm going to be picky with my individual investment decisions. With my passive investments, the things that are going to happen automatically, I'm just gonna keep that on and keep that running, and I want my money constantly being invested into these ETFs. This is where a lot of people think, oh, I need a whole bunch of money to start investing my money and to create an investment plan. But that's just not the case. I mean, you can start investing your money with as little as $100. There are so many apps out there that make investing your money so simple now, and you just have to really start making that decision for yourself and understand what's important to you and what do you want to invest in. If you want to start investing in real estate, that's fine. It's gonna cost you more money. So you need to be more aggressive and putting money aside to invest in real estate. If you don't want to invest in real estate and you want to invest in the stock market, but you also don't want to put in all the work and research into finding the best stocks, then just look into ETFs. An ETF is an exchange-traded fund which gives you exposure to a whole bunch of different stocks. And so you can find an ETF that gives you exposure to the entire stock market. So now, if the stock market goes up, you make more money. If the stock market goes down, you lose money. So that's an easy way for you to get exposure to the stock market without actually putting in a whole bunch of work, because now, instead of you trying to find the perfect company for you to invest in, invest in, you're just investing your money into an ETF. If you want to invest into individual companies and you want to put in the work, that's fine. Just again, make sure you're not overpaying for whatever you're buying, because the next few years are pretty uncertain. We don't know what's going to happen exactly with interest rates. Everybody says that we're going to see low interest rates until 2023 or through the end of 2023. But now we're starting to see kind of conflicting stories. And so you don't want to try to predict the future. You don't want to try to guess the future. You want to just make smart financial decisions that make sense for you today. The last thing you want to be doing as a financially smart investor is to be paying tomorrow's prices for an investment today. I love studying historical trends. And what you see happen anytime a bubble happens is a lot of people start paying tomorrow's prices for an asset today because they always think that these asset prices cannot come down. And then eventually something happens, the bubble bursts, and now you're holding this asset that you overpaid for that is now worth way less than what you paid for it. You saw this exactly happen in the 2008 crash. A lot of people were buying rental properties and losing money every single month, even after they rented their home out, because they thought that they'd be able to sell their home in a year for way more than what they bought it for. So you bought this home, you're renting it out, and you're still paying a few hundred dollars a month to keep this property. And then the 2008 crash came, and now you're completely underwater on this property that you thought that you'd be able to flip for way more money. Don't get into that game of just getting excited and buying on emotion and paying tomorrow's prices. Buy based off of today's prices on investments that make sense for you right now. If you enjoyed this video, here's a video on things you should not do when you get paid that I think you'll love. And while you're at it, download a free money management PDF. And as always, keep hustling. So you have a huge chunk of Americans that are not investing any money. And then you have this big chunk of people that are investing their money, but they're only investing their money in their 401k, and the average contribution is just 7%.